Good morning. Today we are studying concrete technology, and today's content for studying are high performance concrete, its advantages, carbonation attack. What is high performance concrete? A concrete which meets special performance and uniformity requirements that cannot always be achieved routinely by using only conventional materials and normal mixing, placing and curing practices. So a concrete which cannot be achieved by conventional methods and using conventional ingredients and the method of placing, mixing, curing practices. So by using unconventional or modified form of the constituents and the processes, we make high performance concrete, which can be also named as special performance concrete. It is designed for special performance, durability for more strength and longer life when exposed to severe temperature conditions. Due to its low permeability, as we already know, if it is a highly durable, the pores on the surface area of the concrete will be less, and then it will be less permeable. So due to its low permeability, it prevents ingress of water chlorides. So due to its low permeability, the pores will be less, and then there will be less ingress of chloride or less absorption of chlorides, sulfates and other salts, which is achieved by high cement content. Addition of mineral admixture such as fly ash, GBFS. So if you mix fly ash and GBFS, then you can mix, there will be a chance of mixing water chloride, sulfates and other salts, which may be harmful for concrete and its durability. So to stop that, we make concrete with modified form methods and ingredients to achieve low permeability, so that these problems can be subsided. Low water ratio and high amount of superplasticizer were used for desired workability in the concrete matrix. So in a concrete matrix of high performance concrete, we use low water cement ratio and high amount of superplasticizers. So if you use high amount of superplasticizer, then we can achieve a better workability at low water cement ratio. And when, as we have said in last lecture, that if there will be a less water cement ratio, then we can achieve more durability. And that's how we can make a more durable concrete, and that concrete is named as high performance concrete. Excellent workmanship is also required to provide good cover for the structure. So once you make a concrete and again mold it in some element, then at the time of molding or at the time of using the concrete, a good amount of workmanship or skilled labor is required to operate with this kind of concrete, or to mold the elements and providing cover to the elements. So excellent workmanship is also important in this special performance or high performance concrete. So how do we select material? The production of high performance concrete involves the following three important interrelated steps. One, selection of suitable ingredients for concrete having the desired rheological properties, strength, etc. Rheological properties means the flow properties, or once you make concrete, it should have proper workability and consistency so that we can place it at some desired or mold it in desired shape. Determination of relative quantities of ingredients in order to produce durability. So we must have a clear cut idea of how much quantity we will take of different ingredients so that we can achieve a highly durable concrete. Careful quality control of every phase of the concrete making process. We have to be very sure that the quality control in each phase of the concrete must be ensured. The main ingredients of high performance concrete are, apart from these the procedures, the main ingredients which we use in high performance concrete are cement. When looking for cement to be used in high performance concrete, one should choose the cement containing little C3A. C3A means tricalcium aluminate, as possible, because the lower amount of C3A, the easier to control the rheology and lesser the problem of cement superplasticizer compatibility. So if you use more, if you use more amount of C3A, then the compatibility of superplasticizer and cement will affect, and in turn, if it affect, then we know that in high performance concrete we are relying more on superplasticizers for compatibility between cement and superplasticizer. So we must use very less amount of C3A. Finally, from strength point of view, this cement should be finely grounded. This cement should be that much finely grounded so that if we fill in some volume, then there should be more specific area of this cement than the ordinary Portland cement, and contain fair amount of C3A. Then it should contain a fair amount of C3A also. Next is fine aggregate. Coarser sand may be preferred as finer sand, as finer sand increase the water demand of the concrete. We have already said in high performance concrete we must use less water cement ratio. So if we use more amount of finer sand, then the water, as we know that specific surface area of finer sand will be more, then the water demand will increase, water cement ratio will increase, and in turn it will affect the durability of the high performance concrete. The use of coarser sand is highly recommended in high performance concrete, as it usually has largest content of fine particles. It has content of fine particles in the form of cement and mineral admixture such as flat ash, etc. So we must also take care that while using the high performance, or while making high performance concrete, we must use the coarser sand in the available sand nearby our areas, and in that coarser sand, if we have to use the smaller particle to fill in the voids of the coarser sand, we can use the as cement and mineral admixture. The sand particles should also pack to give minimum void ratio, as the test results show that the higher void content leads to requirement of more mixing of water. So if we can fill the matrix properly, the void ratio of the matrix properly, then we can achieve, we can be required very less amount of water to mix. And if we have less amount of water, we can have more durable concrete. Next is coarse aggregate. The coarse aggregate, coarse aggregate means the basalt which we use for the concrete making. The coarse aggregate is the strongest and least porous component of concrete. So we know that concrete, the coarse aggregate contains at 70% of the volume of the concrete, and it is the strongest and least porous component of the concrete. Coarse aggregate in cement concrete contributes to the heterogeneity of the cement. We have assumed that concrete is a homogeneous material, but in real practical life it is a heterogeneous material. By usage of mineral admixture, cement concrete becomes more homogeneous, and there is marked enhancement in the strength properties as well as durability characteristics of concrete. The strength of high performance concrete may be controlled by the strength of coarse aggregate. So we know that 70% of concrete is there, 70% of coarse aggregate is there in cement. So the strength characteristics really depends upon the coarse aggregate. Now the next is water. The strength of cement concrete comes mainly from binding action of the hydrated cement gel. And we know that when we mix water in cement, then a reaction will take place. That reaction will convert C3S, tricalcium silicate, dicalcium silicate, and other constituent Mohs compound into CSH gel. That calcium silicate hydrate gel, this hydrate gel is, they are talking about the CSH gel, which is an adhesive and which binds together the different constituents of concrete to make it as a homogeneous material. The requirement of the water should be reduced so that the required for chemical reaction of unhydrated cement, as the excess water would end up in only formation of undesirable voids in the hardened cement paste in the concrete. As we know, as per the Uniform Building Code, only 0.25 water cement ratio is required for completely hydration of the cement and that reaction. So if we are using minimum 0.5 as per the Uniform Building Code in an ordinary Portland cement, then that obvious that 0.2, the extra 0.25 water cement ratio which we are taking will increase the voids in the concrete, and then that makes the concrete less durable, and that will not result in better concrete performance concrete. Now the next is chemical admixture. Chemical admixtures are the essential ingredients in the concrete mix, as they increase the efficiency of the cement paste by improving workability of the mix, and thereby resulting in considerable decrease of water requirement. So the chemical admixtures, they are essential ingredients. Nowadays we are making high performance concrete and different types of concretes to fill the specific purpose, and for the specific purpose we need the new concrete, innovative type of concrete, and for that we are mixing nowadays chemical admixture as well as other admixtures, and in that when we mix, they increase the efficiency of cement paste by improving workability of the mix. So they actually helps in improving the workability of the mix, and thereby resulting in considerable decrease of water cement ratio. As we know that when we use superplaster as an admixture, it will decrease the water cement ratio of a given concrete, and that water cement ratio will be around 0.25 when we use superplaster as admixture. Different types of chemical admixtures are, these are the different types of admixtures: plasticizers, superplasticizer, retarders, air entering agents. What are these admixtures? Plasticizers and superplasticizers help to disperse the cement particles in the mix and promote mobility of concrete mix. So it mainly helps in mobility and providing the required consistency so that we can name as workable concrete. Retarders help in reduction of initial rate of hydration of cement, so it will increase the initial setting time. Air entraining agents artificially introduce air bubbles, and that air bubbles increase the workability because that bubbles will act as a rollers in the slurry of the concrete and enhance the resistance to deterioration due to freezing and traction. So this air entraining agent, it is made for specific purpose, and the purpose is where the concrete we use in the place where there is a freezing and thawing cycle. Next is mineral admixtures. The major difference between conventional cement concrete and high performance concrete is essentially the use of mineral admixtures in the latter. So if we are using mineral admixture in the high performance concrete, then we obviously making a concrete which is far different from the characteristic of that concrete would be different from the conventional concrete. Some of the mineral admixtures which are using common mineral admixtures are fly ash, silica fumes, carbon black powder, anhydrous gypsum based mineral additives. Mineral admixtures like fly ash and silica fume act as a pozzolanic materials as well as fine fillers. Thereby, the microstructure of the hardened cement matrix becomes denser and stronger. So, we use this silica fume and fly ash, and the matrix becomes denser and stronger, as we have already discussed. This is the property of admixture. The use of silica fume fills the space between cement particles and between aggregate and cement particles. So, it fills the pores, and it is worth noting that the addition of silica fume to the concrete mix does not impart any strength to it. So if we are using silica fume, especially silica fume as a mineral admixture in the concrete, then it just does not add anything to the strength of the concrete, but act as a rapid catalyst to gain the earliest strength. So when we use silica fume, that silica fume does not impart any strength, but it acts as an agent so that the early strength will be more and the hydration process will be far more quicker. Now the latter were the constituents of the high performance concrete. Now what are the advantages of high performance concrete? Increase in mechanical properties for better performance, more durability, more strength, longer life when exposed to severe temperatures, use of low water cement ratio, and more admixtures for better workability. And if you want to talk about the applications of the high-performance computing, we know that where we can use this, we have to use the high-performance computing as per the circumstances and the need. So if we are we have to use a concrete for a specific purpose to make a specific element, then we use the high performance concrete. For example, as if we want to use a concrete at the place where there is a more freezing and thawing cycle, then that high performance concrete can be used very effectively. So next is carbonation. Before carbonation, we must understand then what is a passive layer. And the passive layer is a layer which is formed in a concrete when it is being molded into some element, desired shape element. And that passive layer is formed when the pH will be in the range of 12 to 13. And that range will be named as alkaline condition. So when your concrete, the concrete, freshly formed concrete reaches to the alkaline condition, which is the pH of 12 to 13, then pH of new concrete is, then that passive layer is formed in that concrete. The passive layer is probably part metal oxide or hydroxide parts. So that passive layer may contain a metal oxide layer or hydroxide and part mineral from cement. So it will take different, have this different things, material oxide, hydroxide and the part metal of cement. And especially it contains more amount of CaOH whole twice, calcium hydroxide. The passive layer is a dense impenetrable film which, if fully established and maintained, prevents further corrosion of the steel. So if we maintain this layer around the structure, around the periphery of the steel we have inserted in the RCC element, then it is an impenetrable film, then that steel inside that element will be preserved for a longer period or for the life it is designed. So the question arises, is there any possibility of preserving that layer for a longer period? So answer is that no, it cannot be preserved. Why? Because once you make element, and we know the environment changes, and if it is exposed to the harsher environment, there may be a possibility that when we are making an ordinary Portland cement, then the void ratio and the surface area of the ordinary Portland concrete cement element will have the permeable one. And once the pores are present on the surface, then there will be ingress of chloride or the carbons and other detritivating elements in which carbon is present. So there will be attack through carbonation or chloride into the steel, and that steel into the passive layer, and they will detroit the passive layer at the pass of time. And once they reach to the steel, they will start retroiding the steel as well. So two processes can break the passive environment in concrete and cause corrosion of steel. So that phenomenon of breaking steel known as corrosion of steel, carbonation and chloride attack. Carbon dioxide and chloride ions are very unusual in penetrating concrete without significantly damaging it. So it damages it. Now, what are the causes of steel corrosion in the concrete? This is carbonation, which is one cause. How carbonation takes place? When carbon dioxide comes in contact with water in environment, it forms H2CO3. Then H2CO3 plus calcium hydroxide, which is present in the layer, passive layer of 12 pH to 13 pH, that reacts with H2CO3 and forms CaCO3, calcium carbonate, and plus water. So once we know that when calcium carbonate forms, it will have more volume, and once it is a more volume, it will try to expand itself in the given volume, and it will expand and start cracking and deteriorating the layer of the structure element. Now, what are factors accelerating carbonation? The factors accelerating carbonation are natural concrete cover. We are giving very less cover so that it will be easy for the chlorides and the carbonation, the carbon H2CO3 to ingress quickly. Low cement content. If you are having less cement content, then the production of CaOH will be less, and that will be less in, if this, the passive layer will be weak, then it will ingress easily. High water cement ratio, then the more voids in surface, and then again it will increase ingress in poor clinker concrete. When you have poor clinker concrete, there will be more shrinkage stress. There will be more shrinkage stress, then you will be having more amount of chloride or carbonation will ingress in the end, literally the full element steel. Reduce the CaCO3 will reduce the pH to a level where steel will corrode. So that CaCO3 actually also reduce the period of the pH of the concrete element, the layer, and that will corrode the steel. So cause of steel corrosion can be intentionally or unintentionally. How intentionally? Addition of fluoride set accelerators. We use calcium chloride as accelerator. We can do this intentionally. We don't, despite knowing that it will deteriorate the steel, corrosion can take place, we use the fluoride accelerators. Using sea water in the mix, we are using sea water. And in that sea water, it contains magnesium chloride and some sodium chloride, so it will drip the element. Using contaminated aggregate, so if you use a contaminated aggregate, that aggregate will be again retrieve the concrete element. And how unintentionally? Sea salt spray, direct sea water wetting, exposure of concrete to chemicals. So this is how unintentionally. This is not we do, this is what nature. To like in a nature circumstances provide that thing. So this is how we are divided the chloride ions, how chloride ions reached steel. These are divided into two specifics, intentionally and unintentionally. So with this we know that how steel corrosion takes place, and in the next slides we will study how this carbonation and steel fluoride attack the steel with showing the full flow chart of the carbonation process and fluoride attack process. Thank you.